Walle. You are a professor now at Tone University.
Yep.
And I understand it's quite connected with continental philosophy.
Yeah.
Me personally, I studied at the Sven-Olov University, and I was, of course, involved in analytic.
Yeah.
So, would you care to elaborate a little bit about the differences?
Yeah, I mean, it's
what
Well, I mean, there are some people who don't recognize this divide, but I do. I mean, it's even though, I mean, philosophically there are all these connections, but I mean, institutionally it's still, at least in Sweden and many other places, a fairly strong division between those two traditions. And you can see it in many senses. It has to do with power, money, influence, you know, all kinds of political things. But I mean, there is obviously also a very strong philosophical reason for this division. And it's difficult to say when it actually appeared. When it was consolidated, maybe after the Second World War, you had this. It was more or less consolidated. So you can account for this division in many ways. But I would say that the perhaps most, or at least there are at least two versions of it. I mean, the first would be that in the beginning of the 20th century, you had this division, or this division emerged between two types of philosophy, and they still communicated. There was no distinction analytic continental. These things, really, as I said, as vocabulary, they became entrenched after the Second World War. But I mean, there was one strand which really wanted to have a minimal conception of philosophy. It should be about, you know, securing certain parts of mathematics, formal logic, certain parts of philosophy of language, like in Gottlob Frege's work, for instance. So you would have a minimal definition of sense. To make sense means to be able to be placed inside a formal language where you can univocally decide what is true or false. I mean, it's very minimal. It was very close connected to the natural sciences, of course, and the attempt was often made to bring natural language and philosophy closer to the natural sciences, which, of course, gives a certain program of philosophy. And the other version, I mean, at the same time as Frege and Edmund Husserl in Phenomenology, would say that, well, you know, we need to think of sense, what it means to make sense for a word or an impression or a perception or action. We need to think of that in a much more extended sense. That is, saying true things about the world, this is also a problem for Husserl, of course. This is one of his key problems. But there are many ways in which we can relate to the world which are not really part of a scientific explanation. We fantasize, we remember, we experience, we desire, we feel, we have emotions. All of that must also be part of philosophy. It cannot be excluded as, you know, marginal, trivial things that are not philosophical. So we need to have a much broader conception of what it means to make sense. And this division occurred roughly in the first decade of the at the turn of the century, basically, and these people could still communicate, you know, they exchanged letters, and they could talk to each other, they had different opinions, but they perceived themselves as being part of the same type of philosophy. They just had, you know, different accounts of how to do it. But sometimes in the 20s and 30s, this grew wider, and what would then become the continental tradition became more and more remote from mathematics, logics, and natural science, which is perceived as really a very specialized area, which didn't have to really somehow to do with this larger concept of sense. Whereas the Anglo-Saxon tradition became more and more entrenched in this very specialized area. So in that sense, the traditions really grew apart more and more and more. And after the Second World War, it was even further consolidated. So I think one of the If you would ask a philosopher, if you put 20 philosophers in a room, I actually had this experience, you would ask the question, this actually happened, now is philosophy science? Half of them say yes, half of them say no at the same time. I mean, what does it mean to be a science? I mean, obviously everyone knows that philosophy is not physics, it's not mathematics. I mean, the solution to a problem is not an equation. But philosophy, some people say, should emulate or come close to the natural science. Others say, no, philosophy is much closer to literature, to arts, to other types of experience, which means that philosophical language cannot be this firmly defined conceptual structures you find in the sciences. Other people say, no, we have to go in that way. So the division just grew. And I mean, there is no obvious reason for people to be upset with each other, because you have in comparative literature, you have in history, you know, in all kinds of disciplines, in sociology, you have different traditions and different methods of approaching problems. But the problem in philosophy is that this division is become so aggressive, because I think it has to do with the fact that philosophers, even though they are mistaken, and they are sometimes even historically mistaken about this, they believe themselves to be the guardians of reason. I mean, we philosophers, we are the ones who know what reason is, what truth is, what sense is. So if we somehow fail to provide an account of this, everything will just come apart, which is, of course, pure nonsense. But so these high stakes somehow lead to the idea that, that what the other person is doing is not another type of philosophy. It's not even philosophy at all. Mm. It's just pure nonsense. So after the war, the traditions came apart really vehemently occasionally. And I would say specifically on the part of analytic philosophers, they have been throwing allegations at us. You know, some of them are really funny. I mean, because they are the ones who wield the most power institutionally. It's always easy to make fun of someone when you have all the power in your hands. Mm-hmm. So some of them are very good. You know, in UCLA in California, they would consistently refer to French philosophy as frog fog, which is kind of funny. Ruth Marcus, a very prominent logician, U.S., in a discussion about Derrida, she would say that, you know, there is no distinction between continental and analytic philosophy, just good and bad philosophy. It just happens to be the case that all continental philosophy is bad philosophy. That's also very funny, of course. I like that. But it's not very productive as an attitude, you know, because if you perceive the other person to be either fraud, no, willfully deceiving people, or just insane, it doesn't create a good atmosphere for discussion. So that's one side. But the other side, I think, is more further away in history, and this is becoming, I think, more and more prominent today. And that's the name of Hegel. You know, I mean, like you, I started at the Stockholm University, and we studied analytical philosophy. I mean, we had other teachers, but the canon was analytic philosophy, and everyone would read the same text up to Kant. But then comes Hegel. Then the whole thing just comes apart. So in an analytic account of the history of philosophy, Hegel would be there as some crazy guy who somehow destroyed it. Whereas in my tradition, Hegel would be one of the crucial names to refer to. And I think the reason for this is that Hegel did something which was very much what was rejected in early 20th century analytic philosophy. He says that in order to understand something, we must locate ourselves in history. I mean, to think about a concept, a term, a problem, means to say, where does it come from? Where are we? How do we relate to the tradition? So there's a certain historicity, as it's called, you know, of philosophy. And analytic philosophy, at the beginning of the 20th century, precisely opposed that. History of philosophy is like, it can be interesting if you want to learn things, but it doesn't solve any problems. You know, if you want to solve a problem in mathematical physics, you don't read Aristotle. You look at the recent articles published last week. So in a sense, the history of philosophy disappeared, whereas the history of philosophy became really strong and pervasive in continental tradition. And Hegel is really the kind of point of division here, because of his introduction of history. It's not only Hegel, but Hegel the most important case. Now Hegel is coming back, also in analytic philosophy, interesting, or he's coming back in some ways for various reasons, but I remember I have this American friend, Robert Pippin, who is a great philosopher, reader of Hegel, who's one of those people who cross over between the two traditions. He told me he was in a conference in Oxford at some point, where I think it was Robert Brandom who during a lecture, he mentioned Hegel, and some people say, my God, he said the H word. And it wasn't Husserl, it wasn't Heidegger, because they were already somehow respectable, but it was Hegel, you know, he mentioned the H word. And from that, it was like 30 years ago. So when the H word came back, Hegel, this notion of the history and the fact that to solve a problem means to look at its history has become at least a little bit more prominent in analytic philosophy, but we are still very far apart in some respect. But I mean, for me, that's fine. People do different things, you know. There is no reason to be aggressive about it.
No, but I was going to ask you if it doesn't have anything to do with the fact that Hegel is so closely connected with Marx, for instance, and politics, that it's sort of like...
Yeah.
I mean, isn't that also why he's more popular now? Because people are sort of rereading Marx
yeah.
and Hegel?
Yeah, yeah. Obviously, yeah, Hegel is, of course, I mean, he comes back all the time, but I mean, one shouldn't say that analytic philosophers are not political. They are just as political as everyone else. Some of them are leftist or rightist or whatever, so there's no difference here. Just the way how do you approach the problem, and of course Hegel is, I mean, if you're a Marxist you have to read Hegel in some respects, even though a lot of Marxists would reject Hegel, but I mean he's obviously part of the canon from that point of view. But I mean, I'm just involved right now in a project with my colleagues at Södertörn and some other people, we see who will be part of it, to write the history of 20th century philosophy from 1900 to the present. And not to do as other people have done, you do two volumes, analytic philosophy, continental philosophy, but to do actually one volume that can be used for the students. And that would actually account for the points of contact, points of conflicts, where it comes apart and where they come together, without any partisan aggression, without attempting to show why, because people actually would talk past each other for reasons. It's not because one side was crazy or not, it's because they had conflicting views of what one should do, and to explain how this division was produced and how it transformed historically, it's not necessarily it's not a sufficient way to overcome the divide, but I think it will be a necessary starting point to account for this history in a more neutral way. And I hope we are starting the project, and so I really hope that we'll be able to know this, to see this through in the next 1-2 years. I hope so.
That makes more sense. Should I help you with the food?
Yeah, you can.